So now is my pleasure to introduce our speaker tonight, Dr. John T. Kuehn. Dr. John T. Kuehn currently serves as the Fleet Admiral Ernest J. King Professor of Maritime History at the U.S. Naval War College and is the Emeritus Major General William Stoff Chair of Historical Research at the U.S. Army Command and General Staff College. He retired from the U.S. Navy in 2004 at the rank of commander after 23 years, serving as the naval flight officer flying land and carrier-based aircraft. He has taught a variety of subjects, including military history, at CGSC since 2000. He authored Agents of Innovation, A Military History of Japan from the Age of the Samurai to the 21st Century, Napoleonic Warfare, The Operational Art of the Great Campaigns, and co-authored Eyewitness Pacific Theater with DM Giangreco, as well as numerous articles and editorials, and was awarded a Moncado Prize from the Society for Military History in 2011. His latest book from the Naval Institute Press is America's First General Staff, A Short History of the Rise and Fall of the General Board of the Navy, 1900 through 1950, which is available to purchase in our online store. Now, without further ado, please help me in welcoming from the comfort of wherever you are watching, Dr. John T. Kuehn to our stage.
It's a Royals mask. Well, thank you very much, Camille, and thank you to the World War I Museum for giving me this opportunity to do things kind of a new way. And so I'm really looking forward to this, but I'm really glad that you could join us tonight, wherever you might be. And we'll try to make this worth your while. Next year will be the 100th anniversary of the Washington Naval Arms Conference. I'll talk about that a little bit at the end of the lecture tonight. But that was a great turning point, a great milestone in the history of arms limitation and arms reductions. And arguably, that really got its start at Versailles in 1918 and 1919. So we're going to kind of pull some of those things together, but yeah, we're coming up on the 100th anniversary of the institution of arms control agreements, international law, and the international rule set that to some degree is in danger today. All right, well, let's talk about the Naval Battle of Versailles a bit. I'll move a little slower than I normally do. I like to wander around, but I'll probably try to stay focused and in this one spot. It occurred at the Versailles Peace Conference, but in terms of location, most of the activity we're going to talk about took place between high-ranking diplomats and political leaders of the Allied side, the Allies, who had won the Great War, what we call World War I now, but the Great War, which had just ended in November 1918. So the activity actually didn't take place at Versailles. You know, you think about the great gardens at Versailles, and you're thinking, well, maybe some sort of, you know, maybe they were out in the fountains or something, having a fight in the fountains or something, or putting boats in the fountains out there behind Versailles. No, that's not what happened, you know. So it's actually more correct to call it the Naval Battle of Paris that occurred at the time of the Versailles Conference. And of course, here in Italy, are here all talking to each other at Versailles. Well, the agenda here is to talk about first the context, which is the Great War and the end of the Great War and the treaty that's the conference, peace conference that's taking place at Versailles in 1918-1919. But we're going to have to go back even further than that to a little U.S. history and talk about the 1916 Navy Act. Which is something that is unprecedented in American history in terms of what that act means, because that's why the British and the Americans are not getting along at Versailles in 1919 is because of that Navy Act. Cracks in the alliance. There'll be a standoff. We'll have some high times in Paris. almost some fisticuffs between between political leaders, and then we'll get to a resolution and the way ahead, you know, what lies in the future, what it all means, that kind of thing, and then we'll open it up for questions. Well, I put this one up here just because we often forget that prior to World War I, war was really a two-dimensional affair. It took place at sea and it took place on land. And when we get to World War I, we start having it take place under the water much more so. I mean, there'd been mines, there was the Turtle, there was the Hunley, but I mean, the amount of warfare that actually took place under the water in World War I was unprecedented. And then there's this whole thing of the electromagnetic spectrum, what we today call the cyber world, which can include the electromagnetic spectrum. And so World War I encompassed all of that, and it also took place at sea. So all of these modern types of warfare notions, and people were wrestling with technology and what did technology mean. And as the war came to an end, people were kind of trying to put the genie back in the bottle. They were trying to take all those demons that got out, that Pandora let out, and put them back in the bottle. And most of those demons had to do with technology, and much of that technology had to do with navies. It also had to do with air forces. I'll talk a little bit about that, but mostly we'll be talking about navies tonight. And how do you put the genie back in the bottle? Can you put the genie back in the bottle? All right, go forward. Okay. Think of Versailles as a naval arms conference. There had been international agreements before, but Versailles was really the first time where you got the sorts of arms limitations. Now, nations had been limited in wars in the past, the size of their army, how many forts they could have. But in terms of a regime of naval arms limitation, Versailles is unique. Because what it did was it punished Germany by limiting her armaments. And this is fairly well known. The Versailles Treaty denied Germany dreadnoughts. That is, Germany is not allowed to have battleships anymore, dreadnought battleships. She was allowed to have a couple old pre-dreadnought battleships, which any navy in the world with dreadnoughts could sink in about a half an hour. She was not allowed to have submarines for obvious reasons. And many people thought that had solved the problem of German submarines by having it in a treaty that the German nation could no longer build and have submarines in its navy. She was not allowed to have aircraft or aircraft carriers. Those were forbidden by the treaty for Germany to have that. And it limited her construction to essentially a coast guard. The German navy, in fact, was so small that she couldn't even man the few ships that she was allowed to have. The biggest ship she was allowed to build would be a 10,000-ton ship, and that was as big as a ship as she could build, and she could only build three of those, but if she built three of those, she wouldn't have enough crew to crew the rest of her navy. So Germany was very, very limited. What's not known is that Versailles was also contemplating limits on the United States Navy. The British delegation to Versailles came to Versailles with a list and an agenda to limit American sea power, and we'll talk about that. Because, you know, you're probably going, well, the Americans and the British are allies. You know, why should the British worry about limiting the Americans? Well, you have to remember, until the United States came into the war in 1917, the United States was a neutral advocating freedom of the seas. And we'll get into freedom of the seas again. And that position was violated by Germany declaring unrestricted submarine warfare. The United States, though, that policy was not aimed directly at Germany, but also at Great Britain. So the United States, there were large communities and bodies of political opinion and policy in the United States, including the president, who, when they said strict neutrality, they also meant that the British shouldn't infringe on American neutral rights. So this was a sticking point. The Germans, of course, violated neutral rights because the German violation was so much more violent and egregious, it made the Germans the bigger enemy. But that didn't mean the United States did not still have quite a few complaints against Great Britain for the way she implemented her blockade and restricted American trade on the seas. Okay, so in order to answer that, President Wilson in 1916 proposed a naval act. The 1916 Naval Act. This act was not aimed at just Germany, but it was also aimed at Great Britain, so Great Britain would take the United States seriously. The act aimed at making the United States Navy a Navy second to none. That was how it was pitched. And the United States would have a Navy second to none. And it was a sort of a bumper sticker phrase, and it went over real well with the American public. Wilson brought this act to the U.S. Congress, and it passed. The act intended to build 33 battleships and battle cruisers of the most modern type, 350 smaller warships, that is, cruisers and destroyers, submarines. Included in that bill was $20 million for naval aviation. All right, not so well known that the aviation component of that budget was huge. You can just look at how 20 goes into 300 million. The $300 million of this budget in 1916 dollars was six times as large as the previous largest naval arms budget from the war, from the Spanish-American War. So it was the biggest arms bill in peacetime in American history. Okay, and it was really aimed at the British, and the British knew it. Okay, and they felt like the Americans didn't understand their position, and it antagonized the British leadership, particularly the First Lord of the Admiralty and the First Sea Lord. And we'll talk about those guys here in a second. It would have made the United States Navy superior to the Royal Navy by 1921, mostly due to the modern new designs approved by the premier design approval organization in the United States Navy, the General Board of the Navy, which was composed of admirals and captains, and they approved all the building plans and building designs, as well as wrote all of the war plans for the United States Navy. So that was the General Board of the Navy that had put this thing together. They were supported by a guy who previously had sort of been anti-Navy. He wasn't considered as a friend of the Navy. Secretary of the Navy Josephus Daniels, and after about 2 years in the job as Secretary of the Navy for Woodrow Wilson, Daniels became a hardcore navalist and a big advocate of the United States Navy. So he was probably Wilson's most important cabinet officer. He spent his entire two terms in office. Wilson never replaced him. He was a newspaperman from Fayetteville, North Carolina. And I'll show you a picture of him in a second. But Josephus Daniels, a fascinating guy. There's a new biography out on him what we would call an apology biography. Kind of, it takes Josephus Daniels' side on some of the battles that he fought against the Navy and then for the Navy and then against others. But he was a big, big advocate for a big Navy, and he was also a big advocate for a big Navy to intimidate the United Kingdom. All right, so the British take this bill very seriously. 1917 comes, of course, and things change. The United States and the British are allies. We begin to cooperate. Some of the building gets slowed down so that we can build boats that can participate in anti-submarine warfare, because that's the biggest problem, not fighting German battleships, but fighting German submarines. But the bill is never done away with. The allocations and the apportions for the bill still exist. The spending bills exist. And so the president can build as much or as little as he wants to of this fleet. But he has carte blanche from the Congress to build this fleet. As you can see, here are some of the ships that get created by the bill. The USS Tennessee, a dreadnought battleship that'll be at Pearl Harbor, and then it'll be refloated after Pearl Harbor and participate in great naval battles in the Pacific, including the Battle of Leyte Gulf. And then the battlecruiser USS Saratoga, which will eventually get converted to an aircraft carrier. But these are two of the ships that are paid for by the 1916 Navy Act. All right, a powerful new U.S. Navy. So Great Britain has ruled the seas without any real competitor since Trafalgar. So that's 110 years, 115 years, actually. So this is, and the fact that it is the Americans who the British have not always gotten along with that well. They fought two wars with the Americans, and then in the Civil War, they built blockade runners and raiders for the Confederacy. So the United States and Great Britain don't have a great sort of attitude towards each other with respect to naval power. So the British Royal Navy is very, very intimidated and fearful of this powerful U.S. Navy. The British naval policy has always hinged on having a big navy, the biggest navy. No other navy is allowed to be as big as the British Navy. Any other navy tries to build up to the size of the British Navy, and the British will just simply get involved in a naval arms race. Well, the problem is Great Britain's broke. All the money that has financed the war from about 1915 on is coming from banks, many of them in Wall Street. I always tell my students, Fleet Street, move to Wall Street, okay? So the United States has all the British markers, all right? So financially and economically, the British Empire can't compete. If it is a naval arms race, Britain is gonna lose. And she knows it. She knows it. The other thing is the U-boat campaigns have drastically impacted the British merchant marine, the world's largest, okay? And so the British are really concerned that the U.S. merchant marine, which is now the second largest merchant marine in the world, is making a bid to become the largest bulk cargo carrier in the world. So it's not just the U.S. Navy, but the U.S. merchant navy with a large U.S. Navy to protect it. That is scaring the British. They think the United States is taking advantage of the situation to apply its influence and take a leading position in the world affairs, almost to the point where the United States is beginning to act a bit like they are the hegemon of the globe, not Great Britain. Well, this is true. The United States, the big winner in World War I is the United States of America. And so this lecture kind of highlights why that is the case, all right? So these are the things that concern British policymakers. Here are the troublemakers on the American side. Woodrow Wilson is bargaining from a position of strength, and he has the 14 points. And so he's going to use this big navy to apply pressure to the British to agree to his program outlined in the 14 points so that the war to end all wars is a war to end all wars based on an American plan for a new international order, okay? Next to him are his cohorts. Let me see if I can get a... That is Josephus Daniels. Joe Daniels, Cup of Joe, is named after Joe. Some people don't think so. I'm a firm believer that it is, and I'm in the Navy, so I drink a lot of Cup of Joe, so you're gonna have to go to bat against me, a naval officer who drinks Cups of Joe, to say Cup of Joe is not named after Josephus Daniels. But there are people out there that don't think it is named after him. And that's because he got rid of alcohol, the wine mess on Navy ships, and replaced it with coffee. Next to him is the first chief of naval operations. Tough looking character, huh? Bill Benson. 2 years prior to this photo, William Benson is a captain in the United States Navy. But another act gets William Benson made a rear admiral, and then he becomes a four-star admiral, the first chief of naval operations in American history. Okay, so William Benson is the chief of naval operations. Josephus Daniels is the secretary of the Navy, two of the most powerful men in the world. And they work for one of the most powerful men in the world. Some would say the most powerful man in the world. They're British opponents. The first one is this rascally Welshman, David Lloyd George, who is miffed, to say the least, at the American attitude, which he regards as petty and foolish. Under him is Admiral David Beatty, the commander of the Grand Fleet, the hero of Jutland, you know, the guy whose ships all got blown to pieces, but for some reason he's the hero of Jutland. I don't know why. And he hates the Americans. You might say, no, John, he doesn't really hate the Americans. Yeah, he dislikes Americans because he was married to an American and it was a very ugly divorce. So sometimes that explains a lot, doesn't it? Okay. Sometimes little things like divorces from Americans can lead to bad international relations. So just keep that in mind, folks, when you're considering a divorce. Next to him is the First Sea Lord, Admiral Roslyn Weems. Weems, too, is what we might call anti-American Navy. Yes, he's had to cooperate with the Americans, as have Beatty, but, you know, war makes strange bedfellows. They're not as pleased as they could be with some of the American admirals. They love Admiral William Sims, who's gone out of his way to work with them, who is an Anglophile, that means he loves the British, but these guys regard Daniels, Benson, and even Wilson to a little degree as Anglophobic, and that they're aspiring to a position above their station, as the British might say it, right? And then there's Walter Long, First Lord of the Admiralty. Of the British up here, Long is probably the one who's the most moderate in the group. He's probably the most moderate in the group in terms of being a guy who's willing to compromise. On the American side, Wilson's probably the compromiser. All right, so here's the problem. Two of Wilson's 14 points come in directly to the talks that take place between the naval delegations at Versailles, okay? And so what gets created is a naval committee at Versailles, and so this battle takes place against the backgrounds of the movements and the positioning and the posturing of that naval committee, okay? Wilson's 14 points, the 2 points that are most important to him, the reason the United States got into the war is point two, freedom of the seas, and then of course point one is the League of Nations. Wilson is firmly convinced that if we don't get a League of Nations with the United States and Great Britain and France as members, it won't work and there'll be more war, okay? So for Wilson, it's an article of faith that if there's no League of Nations with American and British participation, we're probably gonna repeat the same mistakes that we've made in the past and have another world war, okay? He also is, remember, the United States isn't an ally, they're an associated power. So he's a little bit miffed, concerned at the naval terms that have been levied on the Germans that I talked about, including the complete surrender of their fleet to Scapa Flow, to the British, and the British drive that up to Scapa Flow, which is where their fleet is parked, to guard it up there. And so they start, there's also this bickering taking place inside the naval committee at Versailles about, well, what do we do with the German fleet? How many German battleships do the Americans get? How many German battleships do the British get? How many German battleships do the French get? How many German and Austrian battleships do the Italians get? And so these things are all taking place against the background there. And finally, you know, should Britain trust this? Is this really, do they really want to put their security in this Wilsonian security basket? Well, the war of words begins, okay? As soon as Wilson finds out that the British want the Americans to cancel the 1916 Naval Building Act, he gets that from Daniels, who gets it from Admiral Benson. He says, we will build the strongest navy that our resources permit and as our people have so long desired, okay? So that's Wilson's position, okay? We're going to blackmail you with our navy. Of course, David Lloyd George, pugnacious Welshman, fires back, we're gonna spend, Great Britain will spend her last guinea to keep a navy superior to that of the United States or any other power. Now he's bluffing because he knows the Americans can make him spend his last guinea and they'll still have billions left to spend. But you know, you gotta be bluff. You gotta be out there, you know? So round one, the British sort of win it. Sorry about the misspelling there, I thought I caught that one. So Lloyd George defers the discussion to the peace conference. Wilson decides to abandon freedom of the seas. He says, we're going to abandon that as one of the 14 points that'll be enshrined in the treaty, because if we have the League of Nations, we will have the the freedom of the seas. The League of Nations will guarantee the freedom of the seas, okay? And the League will be everybody plus outlaw states. The League of Nations will be, you know, like all of us and then, you know, the guys that don't want to play, like the Soviet Union, right? So that's kind of Wilson's position. So he arrives in 10 January 1919 for a dinner in France, and that's where he makes that statement about the Navy, and he's unhappy with the British and the French. Now, the reason he's unhappy is not so much because the British have formally demanded that we abandon our naval building plan, but because the British and the French are behaving very petulantly. Of course, they're both broke, and they need what? They need money. The French are charging us rent for our soldiers who are living in French trenches, okay? Imagine being charged to live in a dirt hole in filth and slime, all right? And then the British are charging for moving American troops on British shipping, exorbitant rates, I might add, to help win the war that British can't win without American troops. So anyway, Wilson's a little miffed about those things. You know how it is, the shooting ends, but then the bills start coming in, right? Okay. All right, so there's Daniels and Benson again in my favorite picture of these two. They continue to lobby the public before they leave for Versailles, saying, hey, support the 1916 Act, support the building plan, let's keep building the ships. Now we've beat the Germans, let's return to our plan to build the biggest navy in the world that will be second to none. And again, second to none is code for just as big or bigger than the British Navy, than the Royal Navy. So Daniels says the U.S. needs a big navy for these reasons. Sounds good, right? We're going to protect the weak. You know, we're going to go out there, we're going to protect the little guy, which is, you know, sort of an American theme. We're for the little guy, right? And we're worried about a league without a world police force, you know? So if we're a member of the league, we're probably going to be the world police force. Ergo, we need a big navy, right? That's the logic train on that by Secretary Daniels. And the U.S. Navy would be the gap filler. Meanwhile, in Japan, whoa, wait a second. You talk about the British, the French, the Americans. Well, what's going on is the Japanese also interpret this building plan as aimed at them. And in part it is. If you're going to build a navy second to none, but you don't plan to fight the British, well, who are you going to fight? Well, you're going to fight Japan if they try to invade the Philippines, right? Which is a contingency plan called War Plan Orange, which the United States has had on the shelf since 1909, all right? So the Japanese have their own building plan called the 8-8 Plan. Now, the Japanese are allied with the British. They signed the Anglo-Japanese Naval Alliance, where the British or the Japanese agreed to come to each other's aid if they're attacked by an aggressor. Okay, it's a defensive treaty. Japan attacks somebody else, Britain doesn't have to help them. Britain attacks somebody else, Japan doesn't have to help them. But it's a defensive treaty, and they were allies in the war. And Japan, you know, helped kind of in the war. They did provide destroyers for anti-submarine warfare during the war. And so Japan was a supportive power, although she didn't really send any troops to fight in Europe. She just took a province of China and kept it, Shandong. So her 8-8 plan, the 8-8 plan is they're going to build 8 battleships and 8 battle cruisers. That's their plan. The problem with the Japanese is they can't afford it. The Japanese government tells the Japanese Navy, good plan, but we don't think we can afford it, right? And the Navy minister, an admiral named Admiral Baron Kato Tomosaburo, is beginning to think maybe we can't afford it. So the Japanese are also interested in ending the naval arms race, but that naval arms race is already ongoing between Japan as well. So the United States is really conducting a naval arms race with Britain and with Japan, okay? And Japan is Britain's allies. If you're very confused, ask me questions during the question period. Well, they create the Naval Committee. I told you about that. Benson's going to be the head of the U.S. delegation, and it'll conclude mostly these guys from the General Board, the guys that came up with the Navy second-to-none plan anyway, the $300 million let's build the biggest Navy in the world plan. They include Admiral A.T. Long, a guy named Captain Frank Schofield, eventually becomes a four-star admiral, commands the U.S. fleet. The Office of Naval Intelligence, Captain Luke McNamee, later an admiral. These are all guys from the General Board. These are basically the American General Staff, all right, Naval General Staff. It also includes Admiral Sims, the only guy on the board who is sensitive and favorable towards the British position is Admiral Sims, is Vice Admiral William Sims. So there is one dissenting voice, but Daniels basically shuts him down. And this begins a long conflict between Daniels and Sims that's sort of peripheral to our discussion. But again, Sims is pretty much gagged. His opinions don't carry any weight in the committee, or they carry little weight. So Daniels arrives at Paris on 25 March. So this is about a month and a half after Wilson gets there, or 2 months after Wilson gets there. And he's directed by Wilson to meet with Walters, who's the first Lord of the Admiralty, kind of the counterpart to the Secretary of the Navy on the British side, and then Benson's counterpart, the first Sea Lord, Admiral Weems, right? This is after the British have let it known that they want the United States to get rid of the naval building plan in exchange for their support and membership in the League of Nations, okay? So that's what the proposed deal is. Benson arrives right after Daniels, and he is supposed to go to a meeting, and he gets there late, and he finds Weems, Admiral British Royal Navy Admiral Weems, badgering Secretary of the Navy, U.S. Secretary of the Navy, Daniels, in his hotel room. And he gets between them and demands naval parity with Admiral Weems. And things kind of go downhill from there. They almost come to blows, okay? The next day, everybody kind of goes home mad, and Colonel House, who's one of Wilson's main advisors, meets with Secretary Daniels, and he says, well, maybe we can end naval construction if that'll get the Brits to agree to the League of Nations. Well, Daniels goes back in and meets with the same three again, and it's a very, very stormy meeting. But this time, the meeting is with the first Lord of the Admiralty, Walter Long. And Long says, no, the Americans have got to stop this naval building plan. I don't know about the League of Nations, but we want you guys to cease building now. Promise us that you'll be. And this is a case of who's going to blink first. Who's going to compromise first? So the British are going to say, okay, we agree to support the League of Nations and be a member. Now will you stop the Navy? They want an act of good faith from the United States. The United States wants an act of good faith from the British. Neither one is willing to make the first move. Benson threatens war. He says, well, if that's your attitude, then, you know, we'll go to war. We'll have a war. You know, this is the last thing anybody wants to hear, is that the two most powerful naval powers of the day, the United Kingdom and the United States, are threatening to go to war with each other over British membership in the League of Nations. Okay, you might think, gosh, this doesn't seem like much of a casus belli, a reason to go to war. But again, these are the leaders of these nations and these navies, and they are very, very hot under the collar about these issues. The U.S. has got to stop building now, and the talks are in jeopardy. This is when Wilson enters the discussion. He kind of says, okay, kids, out of the pool, right? Here's what we're going to do. Secretary Daniels has got to go to Italy on a trip. So he's going to be gone for a week, so why don't we just delay coming to an agreement for a week? And when he gets back, we'll continue the discussion and forget about all this talk of war and everything. Let tempers cool down. So Daniels leaves to go to Italy, and this is after he has breakfast with David Lloyd George. And then Wilson meets with Lloyd George, and that's when the delay is announced for a week. Well, April 6th, 7th comes, and that's the day before Daniels gets back, April 6th, from Italy. And the British kind of blow it. They're like, hey, we can't wait for this guy to come back. We really need to know now if you're going to stop your naval building plan, because it's key and essential. We're trying to come up with our budget. And Wilson goes, well, then promise me you'll join the league. And then they go, no, well, we can't make that promise. And Wilson threatens to leave the conference. So can you imagine, the President of the United States is going to storm out of the conference, who does that sound like, and go home, right? And just kind of abandon these idiots to their fate in Europe and build the world's biggest navy, okay? Well, Daniels returns the next day, and the meetings resume, all right? And Daniels tells Wilson, you know, Britain is trying to dictate naval matters in order to control commerce. In other words, Britain wants to control all the commerce on the seas. They want to limit the American economy, and they want to limit the American ability to do business overseas in open markets according to the policy of the open door, which is an economic policy of open markets for the entire world. So he tells that to Daniels. Daniels is a big fan of trade and open markets, so he goes to Wilson. Well, Weems tries to meet Daniels at a train station. So I've called this the altercation at the station. We didn't have a celebration at the station this year, so what we're going to have instead is an altercation at the station, right? And it's not going to be a protest. It's going to be between the first Sea Lord, Admiral Weems, and Secretary of the Navy, Daniels. So he sort of ambushes Daniels at the train station, the Paris metro station, and before the meeting with the British First Lord of the Admiralty, Long. Well, when Long gets there, he proposes to Daniels that a halt in naval construction for the UK is what they need, and they will agree to support the League if we do that. Kind of, you put your cards down at the same time we put our cards down, and we'll all be friends, right? And so they agree to meet regularly on naval matters. So I imagine how this took place was that Daniels was at the train station, the British Admiral shows up, moves in on him, starts to badger him, Daniels is starting to get upset, and then the First Lord of the Admiralty, Walter Long, comes up and says, no, Admiral, just a second. I think we can resolve this like gentlemen. What's not on the slide is the fact that Wilson told Daniels, you are going to get the British to agree to a League of Nations or else. So Daniels knows he has the authority of the president to make a deal. Another thing they agree to is they agree, you know what, not only will we agree to halt the naval construction on these battleships, not only will they agree to or slow down the naval construction, they'll cut it back, but they'll also agree we're going to meet regularly, annually, on naval matters. So this naval committee, we're going to turn it into sort of a semi-permanent thing. It's not really a part of the League of Nations. It's really an Anglo-American committee that's going to meet. Sometimes the French will come. Sometimes the Italians will come. The guy that's not at the table for all of this, of course, is the Japanese. But they're more than happy to support the British position. But instead of inserting themselves into the process by also demanding the Americans halt it, they figure, well, if we do that, the Americans will really get pissed because then they'll think that the Japanese are trying to influence the British, and that'll make the Americans more intransigent. So the Japanese delegation is really in the background here, and they really kind of finesse the situation to the best advantage. Because at this time, America is a very, very racist country. There are bills being passed in California and other Western states that are pulling Japanese and Chinese school children out of the schools and putting them into the same kind of separate but equal situation that African Americans are in. So the United States is not a place that wants to hear that the Japanese are telling the Americans to stop building ships. The final solution, he's going to sacrifice the freedom of the seas because the League of Nations will guarantee that, and naval parity with Great Britain for the League of Nations, and that becomes the deal. Great Britain will become a charter member of the League of Nations. The aftermath, the German fleet problem, is kind of in the background the whole time. The Germans solved that problem for everybody by scuttling the fleet. And so all of the arguing about who gets what ships, there's only a couple ships left over. One of them is an old battleship called the Ostfriesland, damaged by a mine coming back from Jutland. She's leaky as a sieve. They tow her over to Chesapeake Bay, and some hack named Mitchell sinks her on a clear day without a crew. So that's about the only battleship left over after Scapa Flow, okay? The League of Nations, ironically, the United States gets Britain to sign on to the League, but the United States Senate refuses to ratify the Treaty of Versailles, and so the United States doesn't join the League, okay? And when that happens in 1920, the naval arms race actually starts again, although it's mostly between the Japanese and the Americans. In fact, there's a war scare in 1920 because of American legislation against Japanese and Japanese school children into the United States, particularly in California. At one point in time, California was that way about Asian Americans. Among other things. So that arms race begins in 1920. Britain decides that the United States is just going to have to be lived with, and so they agree to let their treaty with Japan lapse. That's a concession that the Americans had not asked for, but that the British give them. It's sort of a signal, hey, we know we're not going to fight you guys, right? And with that, we get a new administration. But everybody realizes Versailles didn't solve anything. We've still got a naval arms race. How do we stop it? And this time, the Americans will invite everybody to Washington, D.C., to Constitution Hall, which is just across the street from the Vietnam War Memorial. If you've ever been to Washington, D.C., that's where it is. And they'll all gather around a table at Constitution Hall, and the United States will offer to limit armaments and reduce armaments so that the United States and Great Britain will both be equal in terms of the size of their navies. And maybe that's a lecture we can do here in a year or two for the Washington Naval Treaty. So that's the aftermath. Okay, to wrap up, this is an example of something that everybody thinks has solved a major problem, but it's really just kicking the can down the road. And so the Naval Battle of Versailles, which it looks like the British have won, they haven't. They've only delayed the United States' plans to build a navy every bit as big as Great Britain and far more modern in terms of its designs. That Navy, the United States, for example, one of the first things they do is they look at the British Royal Navy's record during the war, particularly Jutland, how ships were blowing up at Jutland, how they performed against the submarines, how the German submarines performed, and the Americans go and get the German damage control and design doctrine for warships and bring that back to the United States and use that as their basis for building American ships, not British designs. So the damage control doctrine of the United States Navy today is German damage control doctrine, because German ships did better in terms of damage control than British ships. So Versailles is just one of those things that it seemed like it had accomplished a lot, but it accomplished very little, and there were outstanding issues that had to still be resolved and would not be resolved for several years to come. And with that, I'm finished and I'm ready to take questions. And thunderous applause for all of you online. You can barely hear me talk because of the thunderous applause. All right, Camille.
John, we're going to give it a few more seconds, and again, we encourage everyone, if you are watching on our YouTube stream, if you're watching on Facebook, don't be shy. We are ready for the questions. All right, here comes our first one. A little bit of humor behind this one, I think. It asks, what did you mean about rascally in regards to Lloyd George?
Oh, yeah. Well, Lloyd George was a pugnacious Welshman. That means he was a combative guy. If you've ever read anything about Lloyd George, he's the perfect guy to have in control in a war, okay? Ruthless, uncompromising, okay? So, and I use the word rascally, you know, maybe pugnacious is a better word, maybe uncompromising is a better word, but he could be very emotional and very ruthless. And he was certainly underwriting the attitudes of the first Sea Lord, Admiral Weems, and as well as the first Lord of the Admiralty, Walter Long.
Our next question. In terms of relative expenditure, how did the 1916 Navy Act compare to the Two Ocean Navy Act of 1940?
Yeah, the two acts are very, very similar. Of course, the Two Ocean Navy Act will dwarf the 1916 Act. It's probably the biggest naval building act in the history of mankind. I mean, the Navy that gets built by that act is going to be a Navy that has over 6,000 warships. Now, that's a reminder to the audience. The United States has 282 ships today, warships, okay? So at the end of World War II, it had something on the order of 6,000 warships, all right? So they were very, very similar, but the Two Ocean Navy Act is even bigger. And what's fascinating, they share a lot in common. They're both passed in peacetime. They're both passed with the United States as a neutral power. The Two Ocean Act, though, is not aimed at Britain. It is aimed squarely at Germany and Japan. It's meant to be an act of deterrence. The Two Ocean Navy Act is an act that's meant to deter Germany from attacking American shipping in the Atlantic, and it's meant to deter Japan from engaging in further aggressive war in China and Asia. And it fails disastrously as a deterrent, but it succeeds fabulously in building a war fleet that can fight on two oceans and defeat the Germans and the Japanese. Of course, with a lot of help from the British, the Canadians, and everybody else in the Atlantic in particular.
Our next question. Did the proposed destruction of the Kiel Canal by the British represent a significant point of contention that perhaps helped create an adversarial relationship between the U.S. and Great Britain?
Yeah, that's part of the background of the Naval Battle of Paris. The Americans were very upset at this sort of, and again, we'll have a similar approach after World War II proposed by the Secretary of the Treasury, Morgenthau. You know, he wants to take Germany back to being an agrarian economy after World War II. His assistant secretary is a Soviet agent. We didn't know that at the time. We find that out after the Cold War. So this idea that the British are going to completely defang Germany, not just militarily but economically, and the Kiel Canal, you know, on the face of it, here's a canal that you can use for interior lines to transfer warships from the Baltic to the North Sea. It really didn't give the Germans much of an advantage during the war. And the Americans regard it more as an attack on commerce and on Germany's future economic viability. The United States is convinced that without an economically healthy and viable Germany, there can be no peace in Europe. Let that sink in, okay? Because that's the plan that's going to be adopted after World War II, sort of in opposition. But it made the Americans only more antagonistic to the British and favorable towards the Germans, too. Remember, the British blockade is ongoing against Germany. The United States is very unhappy with that. In my other lecture, I talked about that the lecture I did on the Navy after World War I and the famine relief that's being done. Oh, at the same time all this is going on, there's this pandemic that's killing millions and millions of people. And many of these people are dying not just from the pandemic, because they're weakened from the blockade. And it's not just Germans, it's Dutch, it's Hungarians, it's Romanians, it's Poles, it's all these sorts of peoples whose infrastructure has been destroyed by the war. And Britain still has this ridiculous blockade in place as a means to sort of prostrate Germany and force her to sign the Treaty of Versailles and agree to these terms, which at the time were regarded as harsh. So the Americans, yeah, they were a little upset.
Our next question. How politically realistic was it to get the consistent funding to actually build to the 1916 plan? After all, USN was never able to build up to treaty levels of cruisers.
Okay, that question has conflated two things. So treaty levels of cruisers is going to be something that is going to be in place after the London Naval Conference of 1930. We're talking about 1919. But the point is well made. So the British are kind of expecting that the United States is bluffing in building all these ships. And then when Wilson and Daniels and Benson get there, and it's clear that if you're not nice to them, they are going to do it. Even if they build half of what they intend to build, the British are going to have a really, really hard time because their naval policy is predicated on being the biggest navy. And if the United States Navy is now the benchmark that you have to be bigger than, are you going to believe that they're going to build all these warships? Certainly the General Board of the Navy and Admiral Benson are saying, yes, we're going to build these ships. Not only do we want to build them, but we can build them, and we have the money to build them. On the other hand, there are the politicians, particularly Wilson, who's a man of peace. Say what you want about Woodrow Wilson. He is a man of peace. So Woodrow Wilson is more than happy to forego the naval building plan if it serves his agenda. And the British are kind of hoping that's what's going to happen. It is what happens, but they sort of play their cards wrong initially when they antagonize Wilson and Daniels. They don't realize that the two guys that are probably the guys they can count on to scale back the naval building are not the two guys that you need to antagonize with combative language.
Our next question. What influence did Alfred Thayer Mahan have on Woodrow Wilson, if any, in the quest to second to none?
He's dead. 1914, A.T. Mahan dies of a broken heart as Europe plunges into war. In fact, he says of it, Europe is now at war due to a series of blunders that sound statesmanship and clear thinking could have prevented. Mahan is gagged in August 1914. Wilson issues a gag order that says no American can write anything on policy about the war, and he has Mahan in mind. And he tells Daniels that if Mahan violates the order and writes pro-British editorials for Forbes magazine or... Let's try it again. Because at this time, Mahan is not writing naval theory. He's a pundit. He's a pundit. So Wilson tells Secretary Daniels to, if Mahan writes anything in favor of the British and violating strict American neutrality, then Mahan will be brought back on active duty and court-martialed, okay? And I think that, to some degree, also sort of contributes, because Mahan has already had an editorial accepted for a magazine. I don't know if it's Forbes or if it's American Century magazine, but he's already had an article accepted for publication, and he has to withdraw the article because Daniels threatens him if he has it published. And it's not even an article on America should go to war with Germany. It's an article on the situation in Europe and why it's of concern to the United States. It's a fairly mild article, but he has to pull it. He's very upset about it. But his influence is through the idea that any naval building plan should be based on the most powerful navy, not the most likely enemy. Let me rephrase that. So you shouldn't base the size of your navy on your most likely enemy. For the United States, the most likely enemy is Japan, not Great Britain. But Mahan says, no, you don't build your navy based on the navy that is probably you're going to fight. You build your navy based on whoever has the most powerful navy. In other words, your benchmark for the size of your navy should be Great Britain or whoever has the biggest navy. That is actually kind of the policy driver here for all these admirals, which is who's ever got the biggest navy controls the world. And so Great Britain is going to have the biggest navy, and the United States, if it wants to be a player with Great Britain and have influence on Great Britain, then she should build her navy as big as Great Britain. Japan also says, well, we should have a navy as big as the Americans. So now you can see why there's this horrible naval arms race that's ongoing, not only before the war with the Germans involved, but with the Japanese, the British, and the Americans after the war. And oh, by the way, the French and the Italians, who are looking at each other and building based on each other. Okay, so all of that navalism has not been put back in a bottle and done away with. So I would say that is part of the influence of Mahan. Is he the only guy with that idea? No, but he's sort of the first one to articulate it, and it does become the policy basis for all of the Navy ministries and naval general staffs of the five most powerful navies in the world after World War I, which are Italy, France, Japan, the United States, and Great Britain.
If there is one thing we should learn from World War I, what would be one lesson you could take away?
Well, obviously, I'm going to offer a naval lesson. I mean, there's so many lessons that we can learn from World War I. You know, the big one is that, you know, just when you think that war is impossible, it's not, okay? Or as Admiral Makarov of the Russian Navy said, remember war, okay? But for Navy guys, I think the lesson here is that particularly in a globalized world, that naval power is not less important, it's more important. Global trade is based on moving the bulk of value and the bulk of goods in shipping. And it seemed like it had reached a climax prior to World War I. And there were even people who thought, well, in the future, bulk goods aren't going to move mostly by the sea anymore. They're going to move by railroads and diesel railroads because oil is so darn cheap and it's everywhere. And they turn out to be wrong, and the shipping that runs the economy of the world today it dwarfs what existed in 1914 and 1919. So what people learn in World War I is never forget the sea.
How's that about a note to end on? Folks, thank you for joining us here this evening, wherever that was from. It was a complete joy. Your questions were really incredible. Thanks to you for participating that way. So on behalf of the National World War I Museum and Memorial, thank you for being part of our program this evening. We so hope that we can have you back in our auditorium soon. And the Museum and Memorial proper is open right now. So if you are ready to come back, we will welcome you with masks and not so close open arms. So a virtual round of applause to Dr. John T. Kuehn for joining us.
Thank you. Great questions. Great questions.